So I want to go into the Word of God this morning. It comes to us from the book of Matthew. And Sister Angela, I heard what you said about the testimony. And indeed, I'm sure that at some point, God is probably going to have me to share some of it, or even the parts that he wants me to share. Because sometimes you can't share the entire testimony, because sometimes it's so unbelievable that God will just have you give it in parts. But I hear you. And I definitely look forward to when the Spirit of the Lord is ready to release that. So from the book of Matthew, chapter 26, verse 41, I just want to deal with not even the whole passage this morning, but as I was seeking the heart of God, he just dropped a rhema. I mean, he just dropped this rhema word in my spirit that it's just been a journey, just unpacking it and talking to God about his heart when he revealed it. From the book of Matthew, chapter 26, verse 41, and it says this, it says, "Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." I'm just going to be mainly dealing with that last portion. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. So I want to talk to us from the topic willing, but weak. Willing, but weak. You may have heard the proverb that says, a chain is as strong as its weakest link. And what does that mean? And how can this help us understand our own weaknesses? So if a chain is holding something and there's a force pulling on it, wherever that chain is weak, It will determine if the chain will break or it will be able to withstand the force that is pulling on it or pressing against it. And that's so important, because that the focus here is not the strength of the chain, but its focus is on the weakness of the chain, because it is where the chain is most weak is where it will face the most pressure, and it is only as strong as that weakest point can withstand the pressure being applied to it. Does that sound like some of our lives, that wherever we are weak, wherever the most pressure is being applied, that is where we oftentimes find ourselves, whether we're up or we're down, whether we're able to stand or whether we break or whether we fall? And I'm sure somebody has been on that cycle for a while, and you're saying, man, sometimes I'm able to stand, sometimes I'm not able to stand. And it's all because of where I am weak. So I want to make something very clear up front. It does not matter how strong you are in other areas. We must pay attention to our areas of weakness. Okay, let me get some witnesses from the Word of God. Just ask Samson, who was able to beat men to a pulp with just the jawbone of a donkey, how his weakness for women caused him to have his eyes poked out and to die with the Philistines. Or just ask David, who wrote, "The Lord is my shepherd," and who wrote some psalms that we quote today and get so much comfort from, because he was in such a place with God, who God described as a man after his own heart. Just ask David how he wasn't able to resist when he saw Bathsheba bathing, when he saw her body and he saw all the curves, and he couldn't resist and ended up killing her husband because of his lust, because of weakness. I wish we would wake up and understand the reality that when we engage in warfare, spiritual warfare, we're engaging also with the fact that we have a weakness. But God said to me, he said, there's some people, there's some people, and we have to introspect and see where we fall into this. There's some people that They've been broken. They're broken. They're going through this cycle of being overcome by their weakness. But rather than repenting and coming before God more broken, they begin to boast from a place of brokenness. You see, the brokenness is not to break us, but to cause us to understand that we are to find our entire strength in God, because we as human beings, we have weaknesses, but there's no weaknesses in God. And when we stand in God, He protects our weaknesses. So we can't afford to boast and ignore our weaknesses, but we are to acknowledge our weaknesses. But we also are to know that God is stronger than any weakness that we have. So I'm helping somebody right now, because you've been in this cycle. You love God. You're, as the scripture is saying, you're willing, but the flesh is weak, and you keep going through this cycle and you feel broken. And God is saying, you need to come to me in that broken state in humility, and don't just ignore the weaknesses that I'm revealing to you. He's saying, don't get caught up in trying to speak over the weaknesses. You got to deal with the weaknesses. You got to get the word of God and deal with the weaknesses. You got to get in your prayer closet and deal with the weaknesses, because we all have weaknesses. No matter how strong you might think you are this morning, we all have weaknesses, and we all have an enemy that knows our weaknesses. But thank God, we have a God that is stronger than any weakness. And when we walk in His Spirit, we can overcome our weaknesses, not in our strength, but in His strength. So sometimes you often hear this terminology that I'm so focused on God that I'm not even studying my weaknesses. And that right there is a deception. Because when you focus on God, He will begin to show you some weaknesses, because He is perfect in every way. And when you come before a holy God, He is going to truly reveal to us our imperfections or our weaknesses. Now, these revelations are not to break us or to discourage us, but to show us where we need to spend some time with Him, really dealing with our weaknesses. So, child of God, a revelation that you're not perfect is not something designed to break you, but it's actually something designed to draw you closer to God, because God is near the broken and those of our contrite heart. So when we begin to see our weaknesses and understand our frailty and our need of God all the time, He can then come closer to us. But what we do sometimes in our pride is, when God begins to reveal our weaknesses, what we do is we begin to feel this condemnation, and then we run from God rather than running to God, when the only reason He's pointing out these weaknesses is so that we can become stronger in Him. So we must deal with our weaknesses and spend time with the scriptures, with the weaknesses that the Holy Spirit revealed to us. We can't talk over them, because Jesus Himself said to His disciples that the Spirit is willing. In other words, I see that you're willing to do what I want you to do, but the flesh, that human nature that you carry, is weak. And that is the reality that we have to face. So sometimes we go around seeking after a prophetic word so that we can feel better, when God has already given us a prophetic word about ourselves, about our weaknesses that we need to deal with. He has already spoken to us about the gossiping, and we have just ignored that. He's spoken to us about us thinking that we're better than others in our heart. He's spoken to us about the reality of resenting our spouses, or the reality of us loving money, or the reality of us sowing discard. These are weaknesses. And the thing is, sometimes it might feel a little strange talking about it, because we're kind of fake sometimes, that we often project this picture that we're these picture perfect people. And the word saint that has never meant perfect in the way we think sometimes. It means that we're mature in God. And that has never denoted flawless. Perfect in Christianity means to be mature. And when we talk about a saint, we're not talking about somebody that's flawless. We're talking about somebody that was once a sinner without God, and God saved them for His purpose to to carry the name and the glory of God. And you ought not to be ashamed to call yourself a saint. You have to say, we are the saints of God. Paul often wrote, when he wrote, he says, to the saints. Sometimes we stay away from the word saint because we feel that we are too wretched, as we learned last week, to say the word saint. But God says that you are worthy. God says, I called you. I cleaned you up. I made you for my glory. And even though you have weaknesses this morning, child of God, God is seeing you and he's saying, I know that you're willing, but the flesh is weak. You got to admit that the flesh is weak. Don't try to run around and boast and make everybody think that you have it all together. It doesn't mean that you're going to go wrong saying exactly what you're struggling with, but your attitude of your heart now has to become one of humility to know that there goes me, if not for the grace of God, as one writer says, the same trap that that person fall into in their weakness, if I'm not careful, I can fall into that same trap. God is saying to us, I see that you're willing, but the flesh is weak. We cannot ignore the flesh. We got to admit that we are weak. But when we admit that we are weak, that in no way minimizes the power of God. Paul says something very interesting in 1 Corinthians chapter 25. I want to read it into your hearing. I'll start from verse 24. He says, but unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. What an awesome scripture. I mean, literally, there's no foolishness with God. Paul was using it comparatively here because God is perfect. What he was saying, so that we can understand in our human mind, is that the weakness of God is stronger than men. So we have a God that we could rest assured that when we give him our lives, when we beg and we call on him and say, God, help me with our weakness, that he has the strength to sustain us. He and only he has the strength to keep us from falling in our weakness. And we have to thank God. Somebody needs to hold on to God even tighter this morning and thank God that he is strong. He is so strong enough. He is omnipotent that we can and trust him with our weaknesses, and he is the one, not unto him, that is able to keep us from falling. What an awesome, awesome, awesome God. If we go a little further to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I want to read from verse 41 to 43 real quickly for you. And it says this, there is one glory of the sun and another glory of the moon and another glory of the stars. For one star differeth from another star in glory. I want somebody to understand that even though you have weaknesses, there's a particular glory that God has ascribed to your life for his honor and his glory. You don't have to look at anybody else's life and envy the glory that God is getting from their life, because there is glory in your life, even in your weakness. He goes on in verse 42. So also in the resurrection of the dead, is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption. It is sown in honor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. What God is saying right now to his children, he's saying, listen, even though you have weakness, continue to seek me, continue to trust me, continue to sow in your weakness, and you will be raised up in the power of God. Child of God, you stop by this morning. You stop by Gospel Radio to be encouraged to go out. That even though you're weak and you feel you're stumbling and you're tripping up, and God is saying, continue to seek me. Continue to sow even in your weakness. Continue to sow faithfulness. Continue to pray. Continue to read. Continue to trust God. And you will be raised up in the power of God. He wants us not to become boastful, but he wants us to be humble. One writer says it like this. He says, we judge ourselves by our intentions, but we judge others by their actions. We got to be careful with that, end quote. Because the scripture is telling us today, the spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Sometimes we judge people in their weakness, just like how we have a weakness. Sometimes we open up our mouth and say the wrong thing. We didn't intend to say it, but we just said it. And then we want to make excuses that, okay, I didn't intend to do it. But when it happens, when we're on the other end of somebody saying the wrong thing to us, we're quick to judge and say that they intended to hurt us. We don't give them the same thing that we give ourselves. And this is where we have to be conscious of our own weaknesses and the weaknesses of others. See, nobody wants to be the weakest link. Nobody wants to be seen as weak. But when we're before God and we cry out to God and we admit our weakness before God, then he can raise us up. The word of God declares, humble ourselves in the sight of God and he will lift us up. Somebody needs to hear this morning that you got to humble yourself in your weakness in the sight of God, and he truly will lift us up. Because sometimes we walk around as if we're not weak and that we don't have anything to worry about. And then we have everybody thinking that we're really this and we're really that. And it's our attitude. God is concerned about the attitude of our hearts. And then when blessings come and we're not the ones in line and first in line for the blessings, then we even have people questioning God, how could you not bless this powerful sister? How could you not bless this powerful brother? And God is saying, because that powerful brother or sister has not dealt with their weaknesses that I have been speaking to them about, and I've put their blessings on hold until they deal with what I have said to them. When God reveals to us our weakness, it's not to help us, because he is a holy God and he wants us to walk in his strength. So the reality is we got some powerful people of God. There's no question that we have this treasure in earthen vessels, and God has called us in our weakness to show forth his glory. But the reality is, and I hope we could deal with this reality and understand that God has not come to condemn his children, but he has come to exalt his full evangelists, but weak in gossip. We got powerful preachers, but weak in money. We got powerful ministers, but weak in arrogance. We got powerful ushers who are weak in bitterness. We got powerful choir members who are weak in stubbornness, and the list goes on and on. But most of all, we have God, who is stronger than our weakness. That when we begin to walk in the fullness of God, our weakness cannot have victory over our lives. Because as believers, we're not fighting for victory, we're fighting from victory. But we got to watch how we walk. Bible says, walk in the spirit and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So we got to walk in the spirit so that our weakness would not take us over. So God is so awesome to us today. He sent this word to tell us that he sees our heart. His flesh is weak. So it's not a matter of if we're weak or not, but how weak is our flesh. And God has sent this word to strengthen us in his spirit, so that we will have dominion over the flesh in the power of the Holy Ghost. So God, we lift you up with a high note of praise for sending this word to us, God. Thank you that you have seen our tears. You have seen our willingness, oh God, but you also know that we have those weaknesses. Thank you for your mercy and not turning your back on us. Thank you for not disqualifying us from your calling on our lives because of our weakness, God. Help us, oh God, with our weaknesses, because we are all weak. But one thing we can rest assured is that you are all powerful and all strong. And when we rest in your arms, you truly give us power and dominion over the flesh and our weaknesses. So we just honor you, God, because you're such an awesome God who has given unto us. You have continued to love us through the good and the bad. And we just thank you, God, that we can rest assured and have that blessed assurance that in you we are strong, and that your grace is sufficient, and that in you no weakness can have dominion over our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.